Welcome to St. Thomas Presbyterian Church. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. We are glad that you have decided to worship with us today. Today is the sixth Sunday after Pentecost. We're to ordinary time in green colors. We have a few announcements. First of all, there are a number of events happening on Zoom. Every Sunday morning is the adult Sunday school class at 9:30. Every Tuesday morning is the devotional group that meets at 10 a.m. Lots of other meetings are happening as well, and you should be getting Zoom messages that you can just click on and join the group. Please join so that we can all be connected as best we can. Now let us worship with praise music.
Yeah. lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. When I feel afraid and think I've lost my way, nothing will I fear as long as you are near. Please be near me to the end. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto and a light unto my path. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path.
As our call to worship, let's center our hearts on these words from Psalm 46. God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in times of trouble. These are words that we need to hear, don't we? And remember that these words are from the Lord during this very difficult time. Let us join together in our prayer of praise. Let us pray. Author of life, living word, holy breath, we have stumbled through the week and groped our way back to you. Illumine the steps before us and write your word on our hearts, for we carry the name of Jesus and would walk in the light of his love. And we all say, Amen.
I sing the mighty power of God that made the mountains rise, that spread the flowing seas abroad and built the lofty skies. I sing the wisdom that ordained the sun to rule the day. The moon shines full at God's command, and all the stars obey. I sing the goodness of the Lord, who filled the earth with food, that spread the flowing seas and then pronounced them good. Lord, how thy wonders are displayed where'er I turn my eye. If I survey the ground I tread, O or gaze upon the sky. There's not a plant or flower below but makes thy glories known, and clouds arise and tempests blow by order from thy throne, while all that borrows life from thee is ever in thy care, and everywhere that we can be, thou God art present there.
The scriptures are full of stories of people just like us. Men who grieved, women who questioned, siblings who did not get along, and parents who chose favorites. God's word of grace is meant for people just like us. There is no need for pretense as we go to God in prayer. Please join me in our prayer of confession. Let us pray. We cast ourselves on your mercy, O God, confessing our betrayal of your love, our misguided responses to your love, and our futile attempts at running away from your love. Help us to trust when nothing seems trustworthy, to hope when everything seems hopeless. For it is in the name of Jesus Christ, our blessed Lord and Savior, that we come. Please take a time for silent confession. And let all God's people say, Amen. Listen now to the assurance of pardon. The promise of the gospel is sure and true. Though we may experience times of darkness and struggle, if we turn our lives over to Christ and rejoice in the Lord, God will give us feet like a deer that tread upon the high places. God gives the gift of joys to those who persevere. Friends, believe and live in the good news that in Jesus Christ we are forgiven.
As it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. Amen.
Please join with me in the prayer of illumination. Let us pray. God of life, by the power of your Spirit, come to us now. Plow our hearts with your living word until we who are broken become fertile with your love. For we long to bear fruit in a world that is wasting. Amen.
Morning, Bert.
Good morning, Ernie.
So, what's the scripture for today? Today's scripture is Matthew 13, otherwise known as the parable of the sower. So what?
So what?
Yeah, Bert. What did he sow?
Oh, well, it really doesn't matter what type of seed it was being sown in the parable. What is important to know is that in the end, the seed represents the word of God.
So the word seed could be bird seed. What?
Okay, Ernie, just listen to the parables for a moment.
Okay, Bert.
The scripture reads, that same day, Jesus went out of the house and sat beside the sea. Such great crowds gathered around him that he got into a boat and sat there, while the whole crowd stood on the beach.
Why did Jesus go sit in a boat?
Well, maybe he was instigating a form of crowd control. Can I continue, Ernie?
Okay, Bert. What next?
And he told them many things in the parables, saying, listen, a sower went out to sow, and as he sowed, some seeds fell on the path, and the birds came and ate them up.
Oh, okay, so the word seed did become bird seed.
Ernie, would you just listen?
Okay, Bert.
Other seeds fell on rocky ground, where they did not have much soil, and they sprang up quickly. since they had no depth of soil. But when the sun rose, they were scorched, and since they had no root, they withered away. So the word was too hot for them to handle. Are you going to let me finish? Sorry, Bert. Continue. Other seeds fell among thorns, and the thorns grew up and choked them. Other seeds fell on good soil and brought forth grain, some hundredfold, some 60, some 30. Let anyone with ears listen. Hey, Bert, I've got ears, but I'm not sure what I just heard. The question is, Ernie, were you really listening? That is the problem Jesus had with the crowd he was talking to. If no one is really listening, it does not matter how much you try to teach. Okay, Bert, I get your point. Well, at least I would get your point better if I spent more time listening. I'm glad you at least recognize that, Ernie. Well, I guess the important thing is that the disciples knew the word that they heard was not absurd. The question about Ernie is, did he really hear?
Our first scripture reading this morning comes from Psalm 119, starting in verse 105. Listen now for the word of the Lord. Your word is a lamp to my feet and a light to my path. I have sworn an oath and confirmed it, to observe your righteous ordinances. I am severely afflicted. Give me life, O Lord, according to your word. Accept my offerings of praise, O Lord, and teach me your ordinances. I hold my life in my hand continually, but I do not forget your law. The wicked have laid a snare for me, but I do not stray from your precepts. Your decrees are my heritage forever. They are the joy of my heart. I incline my heart to perform your statutes forever to the end. Here ends the first reading.
A sower came from ancient hills and cast good seed abroad. His field 10,000 human hearts, his seed the word of God. And some who listened would not hear, and some who heard forgot. But some received in fertile soil the truth the sower taught. A sower walks throughout the land, and everywhere he trod, he sowed his life because he was himself the seed of God. But then atop a barren hill, beneath a darkening sky, they threw God's seed on stony ground and left it there to die. O Christ, you come among us still, the sower and the seed. As once you sowed the truth of God in glowing word and deed, implant your word in waiting hearts it bears in fruitful lives a harvest hundredfold.
Our second scripture reading for today comes from the Gospel of Matthew, the 13th chapter, verses 1 through 9, and then 18 through 23. Listen for the word of the Lord. That same day, Jesus went out of the house and sat beside the sea. Such great crowds gathered around him that he got into a boat and sat there while the whole crowd stood on the beach. And he told them many things in parables, saying, "Listen, a sower went out to sow, and as he sowed, some seeds fell on the path. And the birds came and ate them up. Other seeds fell on rocky ground, where they did not have much soil. And they sprang up quickly, since they had no depth of soil. But when the sun rose, they were scorched. And since they had no root, they withered away. Other seeds fell among thorns, and the thorns grew up and choked them. Other seeds fell on good soil and brought forth grain, some 100-fold, some 60, some 30. Let anyone with ears hear. To verse 18. Hear then the parable of the sower. When anyone hears the word of the kingdom and does not understand it, the evil one comes and snatches away what is sown in the heart. This is what was sown on the path. As for what was sown on rocky ground, this is the one who hears the word and immediately receives it with joy. Yet such a person has no root, but endures only for a while. And when trouble or persecution arises on account of the word, that person immediately falls away. As for what was sown among thorns, this is the one who hears the word, but the cares of the world and the lure of wealth choke the word, and it yields nothing. But as for what was sown on good soil, this is the one who hears the word and understands it, who indeed bears fruit and yields, in one case 100-fold, in another 60, and in another 30. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Our scripture says Jesus was sitting beside the sea and a great crowd gathered around him. It was so large that Jesus got in a boat and moved away from the shore a bit. Then he sat down in the boat and began to teach. The people on the beach are listening. And he began with a parable commonly called the parable of the sower. This parable appears in three of the four gospels and is the first parable Jesus told. Therefore, it gets star billing. It receives a large amount of space in the gospels, 23 verses in Matthew, 25 verses in Mark, and 15 in Luke. When the Gospels give this much time to any story or parable, we need to pay close attention. In Jesus' day, the most common method of planting was casting seed. In other words, throwing the seeds out and letting them fall wherever. Sometimes the seeds fell on good soil and produced abundantly. Yet in three of the four examples Jesus gave in this parable, the seeds fall in less than ideal soil, and the results are not very good. Most scholars agree that the sower is Christ, who came to sow the seeds of the kingdom. Yet this parable seems to be more about seeds and soil than the sower. So we wonder what the good seeds and the good soil represent in this parable. The disciples weren't sure, so they asked Jesus for an explanation. That's the second part of our scripture reading. Now, we could say that we're in pretty good company with the 12 disciples. Yet think about how often they didn't understand Jesus. It is somewhat comforting to me, though, to think the disciples were right there with Jesus, and they still didn't understand everything he said. Yet, we have the Bible, and they didn't have that. And we have gazillions of books on theology offering all kinds of different opinions, some which may help and some which may confuse us. But I'm grateful that the disciples asked Jesus for an explanation. So let's go directly to the explanation. First, Jesus said, when anyone hears the word of the kingdom and does not understand it, the evil one comes and snatches away what is sown in the heart. This is what was sown on the path. So, what is the word of the kingdom? In the Gospel of Matthew, there are 54 references to kingdom, and 38 to the kingdom of heaven or God or its equivalent. And all are spoken by or related to Jesus. And the majority are located in Jesus' 5 great discourses in the Gospel of Matthew. It is also Matthew who places special emphasis on preaching the gospel of the kingdom, which is closely related to Jesus' life, his ministry, his teachings, and is demonstrated through the miracles and the forgiveness and the healing. So in the second example of seed sown on rocky ground, Jesus explains, this is the one who hears the word and immediately receives it with joy. Yet such a person has no root, but endures only for a while. And when trouble or persecution arises on account of the word, that person immediately falls away. Now, I have sympathy for those seeds cast on the rocky ground. Persecution is difficult stuff. Yet these seeds are without a root. And in the third less than ideal situation, Jesus says, as for what was sown among thorns, this is the one who hears the word, but the cares of the world and the lure of wealth choke the word, and it yields nothing. Our world seems to be filled with thorns right now, and they are challenging each and every one of us. Our thorns include the COVID-19 pandemic, racial discrimination issues, and effects of police brutality. And I will add, being unable to worship together in person has to be seen as a significant thorn. And the lure of wealth is always a real and present danger. And finally, we arrive at the best outcome in the parable. But as for what was sown on good soil, Jesus says, this is the one who hears the word and understands it, who indeed bears fruit and yields, in one case 100-fold, in another 60, and in another 30. It sounds as if a seed sown in good soil is a person who hears the word, understands it, and produces good works in the kingdom. So first, there must be a hearing of the word, the living word in Jesus. One good way to hear about the kingdom is through the Bible. And so we read. I don't know about you, but it is becoming increasingly more difficult for me to remember where a particular passage is found. I love the Psalms and some of the wonderful thoughts expressed in them, like this one, my favorite. For as the heavens are high above the earth, so great is his steadfast love toward those who fear him. As far as the east is from the west, so far God removes our transgressions from us. What an awesome, awesome statement. And it comes from Psalm 103, but I always have to look it up. I can remember the thought and the general meaning, but not every word, not that it comes from Psalm 103. I read a story about a young believer who was discouraged in his attempt to read and remember the Bible. He said, "It's no use. No matter how much I read, I always forget what I just read." A wise pastor replied, "Take heart. When you pour water over a sieve, no matter how much you pour, you don't collect much, but at least you end up with a clean sieve." So I ask, has it happened that you read a passage and it means one thing, and the next time you read it, it means something totally different? I write notes in the margins of my Bibles, and sometimes I look at those notes and realize the scripture means something totally different to me now. And we Presbyterians believe that the Holy Spirit is with us as we read and study, as we discuss and think about what the Bible says. That's why we say the prayer for illumination before we read scripture and even before the children's sermon. Reading scripture and preaching a sermon are under the direction of the Holy Spirit. And each time we read a scripture, we are at a different place in our life. Some seem to expect the Word of God with a capital W to hit them like a jolt of adrenaline each time they read or study it. And although the jolt may hit us periodically, the benefits of the Word of God are more like vitamins. People who regularly take vitamins do so because of the long-term benefits, not because every time they swallow one of the pills, they feel new strength surging through their bodies. They have developed a habit of consistently taking vitamins because they have been told that in the long haul, vitamin supplements are going to have a beneficial effect on their physical health, their resistance to disease, and their general well-being. The same is true of reading the Bible. At times, it will have a sudden and intense impact on us. However, the real value lies in the cumulative effects that long-term exposure to God's Word will bring to each of our lives. One of the things I have learned over the years is how beneficial it is to participate in a Bible study. It's good because we hear others' opinions, ideas, beliefs. It opens up our minds to new understandings. And often our different understandings challenge us to grow, both biblically and theologically. For about 4 years, I led Disciple Bible Study each year. Each time we would use the same manual, but with different people and different discussions. And each year, this survey of the entire Bible was amazingly different. And this study would teach me and challenge me and enrich my life. The Bible helps us grow a strong root. It is also like those vitamins for our journey through life. Studying the Bible in Sunday school, in a Bible study, in a Christ care group, or individually makes us stronger. So let's go back to those seeds in the soil. This parable reminds me of the old Miracle-Gro advertisements. Do you remember those? On one side would be a picture of this kind of puny little plant, you know, small. And then on the other side is a picture of a much larger plant with blossoms or fruit or whatever. And what's the difference? Well, Miracle-Gro, of course, of course. And I believe that studying God's word is like Miracle-Gro. It feeds our soul. It encourages a strong root system, and it causes many more beautiful blooms. The soil will be enriched with hearing the word and understanding it. Learning about the kingdom of God and the wonderful stories of God's people throughout history enriches and fertilizes the soil and helps the seeds grow. It's the place where we can put down some roots, some strong roots that will hold us steady even during difficult times, like living in and through a pandemic. The fertilizer is God's word, the sower is Jesus Christ, and we are the seeds. And we will get through whatever trials and tribulations we face because our roots are strong. In the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, and we all say, Amen.
A spring that waits to be unrevealed until its season, something God alone can see. There's a song in every silence, seeking word and melody. There's a dawn in every darkness, bringing hope to you and me. From the past will come the future, what it holds a mystery, unrevealed until its season, something God alone can see. In our end is our beginning, in our time infinity. In our doubt there is believing, in our life eternity. In our death our resurrection, at the last our victory. Unrevealed until its season, something God alone can see.
Please join me as we together affirm our faith using words from the letter to the Colossians. Jesus Christ is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of all creation. In him all things in heaven and on earth were created, things visible and invisible. All things have been created through him and for him. He himself is before all things, and in him all things hold together. He is the head of the body, the church. He is the beginning, the firstborn of the dead, so that he might come to have first place in everything. For in him all the fullness of God was pleased to dwell, and through him God was pleased to reconcile all things, whether on earth or in heaven, by making peace through the blood of his cross. Amen.
Please join with me in the prayers of the people and the Lord's Prayer. Let us pray. Holy God, we were yours before we drew breath, and still we will be yours when the pulse of life ceases. In every fragile, reckless moment, we belong to you. We thank you for the desire of our parents who gave us life. May the love we have received spill gratitude from our hearts. May the wounds we carry open our hearts to the needs of others. May we recognize in your mercy the faithfulness that judges and redeems every human bond. We lift to you now all that seems irreconcilable in our families, in our schools and workplaces, in our nation, in your people in the church, in your world. We pray for those we identify as leaders in every sphere of life. We pray for our president and for all whose decisions weigh heavily on others. Even so, Lord, give us the courage to name ourselves as those whose responsibility is great. Teach us to act, to tend the world you love, to sow more than we reap, to heal more than we wound, to make room for others as you made room for us. Redeeming God, stake your claim upon us now until we hear your gospel echo in each stranger's story as we see your image reflected on every wounded face. For we pray in the name of Jesus, who taught us to pray, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
As we continue to worship remotely, you can still mail your offerings and tithes to the church office, or you can use the online giving tool in the link to the video description in this video or on the church's website. We continue to be blown away by the generosity of this congregation. And if there's anything that you need during this time that we are not aware of, please let us know so that we can try to help meet that need. Hear now this invitation to the offering. We bring our gifts because the tendrils of God's love have worked their ways into the soil of our hearts. Sisters and brothers, let us yield our lives to God's abundant harvest.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise him, all creatures here below. Praise him above, ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost.
Let us pray. Giver of life, we do not want the cares of the world and the lure of wealth to choke your word among us. As the sower casts seeds abundantly, hopefully, so we long to participate in your seeding of the world. Receive these gifts as tokens of our lives. Send your cultivating spirit to work among us until we yield and grow in grace. For we pray in the name of Jesus, who came out of love for the world. Amen.
Cantad al Señor un cántico nuevo. Cantad al Señor un cántico nuevo. cantar al Señor, un cántico nuevo, cantar al Señor, cantar al Señor. Oh, sing to the Lord, oh, sing God a new song, oh, sing to the Lord, oh, sing God a new song, oh, sing to the Lord, oh, sing God a new song, oh, sing to our God, oh, sing to our God. For God is the Lord, and God has done wonders. For God is the Lord, and God has done wonders. For God is the Lord, and God has done wonders. Oh, sing to our God, oh, sing to our God. Oh, shout to our God, who gave us the Spirit. Oh, shout to our God, who gave us the Spirit. Oh, shout to our God, who gave us the Spirit. Oh, sing to our God, oh, sing.
Friends, as you go out from your place, as we go out from this place, I would invite you to spend some time every day in Scripture, whether it's reading a little bit of a psalm, whether it's reading a Scripture in which Jesus speaks about and teaches about something. Spend a little bit of time every day, and it will help your roots grow stronger as we go through this difficult time in our world. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, the communion of the Holy Spirit be with each of you now and forever. And we all say, Amen.